Most people know that there are massive riots going on in the US. George Floyd, a black man accused of a petty crime, died in police custody due to the excessive use of force by a white cop, causing virtually the whole country to erupt with retaliatory violence. As the news of Floyd's death spread, there were some genuine peaceful protests. But soon enough, people of this far-left group called Antifa, who were mostly white Americans, began to unleash violence in various parts of the country. These Antifa criminals tried to push some blacks to the forefront to gain credibility in the eyes of the public, but soon enough threw caution to the wind and started looting stores and damaging public property. I don't know enough about American society, and I will refrain from commenting on the prevalence of institutionalized racism or the lack thereof. But to my limited understanding, it surely looked like police brutality. Whereas the police officer may or may not have had racist motivation per se, but overall, what transpired did not seem to reflect the alleged widespread racism in American society. That said, my specific interest in all this is in the dynamics of violence that follows such trigger events and the role that narratives play in flaring things up. Meanwhile, here in India, I saw a WhatsApp message that was titled Sab Yaad Rakha Jayega, that is, we will remember everything. And it was a call for nationwide protest on June 3rd, which was yesterday, against repression of anti-CAA activists and democratic voices of dissent. So what is this protest about, and why is this being organized at this extremely critical time when India is on the brink of an explosion of COVID-19 as the lockdown is being lifted in various parts of the country for economic reasons? If the protest indeed happened, why did the state allow it? I don't really know if it happened or not. But these are questions that must be answered if you are to make sense of the life-threatening danger that is silently engulfing the bubble of your affluence-induced safety. The key to understanding the logic of the protests is to answer the moot question, why now, in the middle of the community transmission stage of COVID-19 in India? The simple answer is that this is an opportune moment for soft terror groups in India to normalize their violent agenda in the garb of showing solidarity with African Americans. In the days to come, anti-racism protests in America will be projected as a variation of anti-CAA protests in India, or vice versa. As I said, we can be careful about and tentative about forming an opinion on what is happening in American society. But will the other side reciprocate? No. India is a land of caste, curry and cow, where minorities are oppressed. That's the global narrative. And here's the really fascinating part. The foot soldiers of the anti-CAA or not in my name protests that you see on TV, who account for the groundswell and the numbers that provide the necessary cushion for the violent few, are driven by narrative, not by reality. One of the most effective tools to enhance the narrative that suits your agenda is this thing called verbal cleansing. This is a technique mastered by the Global Rainbow Alliance of communists and Islamists. Like how hardcore Kashmiri terrorists like Yasin Malik, they've been converted into political leaders by calling them separatists. A terrorist terrorizes people, a separatist just wants political independence. So you're made to think. Likewise, anti-CAA criminals are called activists, and subtle calls for destruction and genocide are marketed as dissent. Accordingly, the protest call that I just read out, which says repression on anti-CAA activists and democratic voices of dissent, should actually read as legal action on anti-CAA terrorists giving calls for violence and genocide of Hindus. This is exactly what Hinduon Se Azadi meant. Back to the global spread of violence. There were protests in New Zealand and many cities in Europe too. It is obvious that most people in these demonstrations are young, affluent, and privileged in their own lingo. Most of them belong to the same majority groups that are supposedly exploitative. Thus, there seems to be a large section of college-going youth in the democratic world that forms the pipeline of recruitment of foot soldiers for such protests. These are people who have been primed for participation by long-term exposure to a single narrative, introduced as a part of their university curriculum very often, and reinforced by the messaging in media and pop culture. As they have no access to competing explanations, their worldview is reduced to a meme, like revolution, class struggle, or patriarchy. The meaning in their life comes from waiting for a signal, a trigger, or a call for action. And they come out on the streets seeking justice for a crime they don't even understand. Working behind the scenes, providing logistical support and muscle power, are interest groups and organizations of all kinds. Religious institutions, NGOs, PR agencies, political parties, and so on. Let's try and understand the psychology of these foot soldiers and how they act as cannon fodder for the interest groups that recruit them. First, a very brief comment on game theory, which is basically an approach of analyzing decision making by studying the interactions between players as a rational set of rational choices. It is a theory that many great scholars and thinkers have built upon to come up with mathematical models and solving real-world problems through the same. One of the most popular ways of understanding decision-making by individuals, corporations, and societies is by trying to fit them into the paradigm of finite versus infinite games. A finite game is one that is played for the purpose of winning, an infinite game for the purpose of continuing the play. T20 cricket, for example, is a finite game. Creating music in a rock band is an infinite game. A finite game has explicit rules and boundaries, whereas an infinite game, rules and boundaries change with time. An infinite game often contains numerous finite games. So when you put two opponents against each other, the system is stable if both are of the same mindset, finite or infinite. A game of T20 cricket is stable, and so is a rock band, before they get famous at least. But what happens when a finite player is pitted against an infinite player? The finite player always loses because he is playing according to certain rules. And the only rule applicable to the other side is to continue playing. So when there is an attack on the armed forces in Kashmir, for example, a handful of terrorists are always at an advantage against the whole army unit because the attack is asymmetric. The army is playing by the rules and the terrorists have no rules. In other words, the army is a finite player and the terrorists are the infinite player. That's why celebrating the killing of terrorists is juvenile, because finite victories in an infinite contest are actually meaningless. What about narratives then? People who create narratives, artists, journalists, filmmakers, writers, they are formally trained to use their talent in the service of perpetuating the narrative of the institution that they come from. Similarly, when young university students with no exposure to their sacred tradition, when they are exposed to the mainstream academic discourse, they get taken in by these ideas and turn against their own tradition, ending up as foot soldiers for the adversary. Narratives are an infinite game. People are often perplexed by the image of radical Islamists whose religion orders death for sodomy, participating with great enthusiasm in gay pride marches. Or when a far-out feminist shamelessly declares that hijab is liberating. Remember, they're playing an infinite game where temporary alliances can be formed overlooking serious doctrinal differences, if that helps both the players perpetuate their respective narratives. This is precisely what makes a game infinite. It is the contempt for rules and consequently an indifference towards who wins the smaller finite game. But beneath all the temporary compromises is the unbending commitment to the propagation of certain values. All the adversaries that Hindus are faced with today, their values are religious, ideological, commercial, or civilizational. Christianity, Islam, communism, and consumerism have expansive ambitions, and they play the infinite game of world domination. Christian missions say that the third millennium belongs to the Christ. The Chinese have an aggressive geopolitical plan for the next 100 years. Islam is demographically capturing Europe. Even multinational companies have a roadmap for growth over several decades. The Hindu horizon is limited to the next assembly election. Modern Hindus deal with narratives in the most unimaginative way possible because they are playing a finite game in which they are competing to be the nicest person in the boxing ring who complains to the non-existent referee every time someone lands a blow on his pink cheeks. By the way, this game, along with cricket, was taught to the Hindu by his colonial masters as they plundered his motherland. In Huntington's theory of the clash of civilizations, Hindu civilization is one of the players. Unfortunately, Hindus are playing to win a finite battle, when the clash happens to be an infinite game. In the Hindu finite game mindset, rules have replaced values. Conformity has replaced ambition. Platitudes have replaced clarity of thought, and emotionalism has replaced the intellect. Supposedly, Hindu organizations have no civilizational vision, which is why 1 billion Hindus don't have a single think tank worth its name, nor a single mainstream media house, not even a social media platform of our own. Hindu temples are controlled by the government, their funds misappropriated for secular causes, including corruption. And many of our gods, their precious murtis, are languishing in museums abroad. Why would Hindus care? They don't worship their gods anymore. They've also become people of the book. Just that the book happens to be the holy constitution. The future of Hindu civilization is bleak. If you say that Bharat survived for thousands of years and will continue to survive, I think you're wrong. Wake up and smell the coffee. 70 years of political independence have in many ways made the situation worse for us. If we are to survive the clash of civilizations, we will need to play it like an infinite game. Putting your favorite politician in the parliament is a finite win. It really means nothing in the bigger picture. We need to stop depending on the state, quit looking for solutions in electoral politics, which is yet another infinite game, pretty much out of our reach. Get real. Know that there are no shortcuts to building and supporting your own elite institutions that authentically represent your civilization. Institutions that can talk back to the adversary and land a solid blow, as it were. Only then will you be equipped to break the habit of being the nicest guy in the boxing ring and participate in the infinite game as a worthy inheritor of your glorious ancestors whose contribution to the world was unparalleled. As someone has said, India has forgotten a lot more than other civilizations even remember. But let us not forget how we played the game.